Welcome to Someone Talked, the official podcast of the National D-Day Memorial, where leading experts spill all the secrets of the Second World War, with your host, Dr. John C. McManus.
Greetings. Welcome to Someone Talked. I'm your host, Dr. John C. McManus, Curious Distinguished Professor of U.S. Military History at Missouri S&T, and alongside, as always, are my dear friends from the National D-Day Memorial Foundation, April Cheek Messier, John Long, and Angela Lynch today, too. How are y'all?
Fantastic.
Great.
Doing well today.
Well, it's, obviously, we love what we do. And one of the many reasons why we love doing this podcast is the incredible people we get to speak with. So today, we're really honored to have Major General Mary Eder, who served 36 years in the United States Army in many different roles. Of course, she was branched as a signals officer. She was Deputy Chief of the United States Army Reserve, Deputy Chief of the United States Army Public Affairs. She was Commanding General of the U.S. Army Reserve Joint Special Troops Support Command. I mean, what hasn't she done? In addition, of course, to writing an amazing book that we all really enjoyed called The Girls Who Stepped Out of Line, which is our focus today. But General, I just wanted to welcome you today and say it's an incredible honor to have you on.
Thank you so much. I'm thrilled to be here.
Well, you know, the place to start, I think, in our conversation is, of course, some of the background on what leads you to this book. I mean, you know, you could argue that that your career is maybe not possible without the efforts and the sacrifices of many who came before. And so I guess, you know, my initial question for you is, you know, how would you say women of the World War II era smoothed the paths for military careers for someone of your generation?
Well, World War II was the first time that women had been encouraged to join the military. There were some who served in World War I. The hello girls, the telephone operators, of course, those who were in the medical corps and some administrative people. But in World War II, women were permitted to join in large numbers. There were 350,000 women who served in World War II in all branches. And so the training centers were built and the numbers came in. And all of those who wanted to serve their country now had a way to do it.
So, Mary Kay, and I apologize, I have a little bit of laryngitis today, but I have to, first of all, thank you so much for being with us. Last Veterans Day, you did an amazing job. So many people interested in your book, and I just have to say, the book is fantastic for anyone who doesn't have it. It's such a phenomenal insight into these incredible women of all backgrounds, and what I love about the book is you really focus on women who came from so many different backgrounds, and they did so many different things. Their achievements were everything from whether it was in nursing to working as a code breaker to literally spies or whatever, you know, helping rescue downed pilots, resistance fighters, things of that sort. Just remarkable. So thank you for kind of bringing all of that together for us to look at it in your book. But can you tell us about the title? How did you come up with that? Why is it important?
Sure. Well, in 2017, I was asked to speak at a conference, and I was a substitute. The main speaker had dropped out, and so I had about 2 weeks to prepare. I had been reading obituaries. I know how that sounds, but as the members of the Greatest Generation leave this earth in ever larger numbers, I've been seeing more of these stories that I'd never heard before. I'd saved a couple of them, and I used them in this presentation. And then I kept looking for more until I had a large folder full of them. In 2019, Alex Borstein received the Emmy Award for Best Supporting Actress for her role in Mrs. Maisel. And when she stood up to receive it, she said, "In World War II, my grandmother was about to be shot into a pit. She turned to the guard and said, 'What happens if I step out of line?' And he said, 'Well, I don't have the heart to shoot you, but somebody will.' She stepped out of line. And for that, I am here today. And my children are here today. So step out of line, ladies, step out of line." And that's where the title came from.
Yeah, I mean, it's a powerful message. And, you know, just to kind of revisit what the World War II generation was doing, and to some extent, the Vietnam generation, too. It was people stepping on line because, you know, for many of the women who joined the armed force in World War II, that was not that highly approved by some of their families. It was not always that socially well approved. And I think the same thing is somewhat true in the Vietnam era, especially for the Women's Army Corps, that's having to kind of fight for, you know, for sort of equivalency, you know, alongside many of the others who are serving in Vietnam, and then many of the male soldiers, too. And it's just really interesting to me that you commissioned in 1977, which is right after this has happened in the beginning of gender integration. You know, so for instance, the year before is the first cadets, female cadets at West Point, and the first female midshipmen and airmen at the Air Force Academy and all that. So, you know, you're sort of immersed in this world that's been that has led to your career in some ways. Were you thinking about that back then? Did that sort of inform your longer journey toward this book? How did all that work for you?
I think I was oblivious to any historical connections right when I first came into the Army. My older brother had served in Vietnam, and I was a very competitive kid, and if he could do it, I could do it. And that's pretty much what started me on my role in coming into the Army. The Women's Army Corps was still active then. It was disestablished a year later. So in 1977, I was aware that I was part of the Women's Army Corps. And of course, we had books on its history, but I don't think I made the connections, not for a long time, to truly understand how much each generation builds on the next and how much we stand on their shoulders for what they accomplished. Because for those women who served in World War II, all of their orders read for the duration plus 6 months. So even at the end of 1944, the WASP had been disestablished. The training centers were beginning to slow. And at the end of the war, they were shutting down. But in 1947, President Truman said that women would become a permanent part of the armed forces. And so the Women's Army Corps stayed. Women in the Coast Guard stayed. Women in the Army Air Corps stayed. And in the Marine Corps. So, and in the Navy. So it continued. And it's grown since then. And it continues to change and grow today. We now have the first woman 4-star on the Joint Chiefs. We have numbers of opportunities now we didn't have before, even a generation ago, even as I entered the Army. But you know, I think it's time to be beyond firsts. Now, it's wonderful to celebrate them, yes, but there shouldn't be any more firsts, I don't think.
Well, let's talk about the very first heroine you highlight in your book, Alice Marble. Did I say that right? Is it Marble?
Yes.
Okay. Alice Marble, most people associate that name with the game of tennis, but you tell a lot more about her role in the war. So tell us a little bit about Alice and what she did for the war effort.
Alice Marble was really a tennis sensation in the 1930s. I have many more photos of her during that time that I was unable to use because you have to be so careful with the provenance of them. She played tennis competitively for about 10 years, won a number of what we call today Grand Slam competitions, but she wasn't making much money. And so she decided to retire from her amateur status, go professional and tour. Unfortunately, her timing wasn't great, and that was in 1940. So she's just coming into that era when there's Pearl Harbor, the war starts, and the only place to play now is in competitions that are demonstrations for troops. So one of the things she wanted to do was join. She couldn't. She'd been ill as a child, so she wasn't able to join the military. But I think in World War II, everybody had a uniform of some kind. And even the entertainers had uniforms. So she performed in USO shows, but she did something a little bit beyond that. She went undercover, if you will, overseas, pretending to play in a match in Switzerland, and she gained entry into, well, I don't want to tell the whole story, but she certainly was able to learn quite a bit about how the Nazis were laundering money with the Swiss. And some of what she found out and used was later part of the Nuremberg trials.
General Alice was also one of the originators of the comic book character Wonder Woman. I'm very excited to ask this question as a Wonder Woman fan growing up, of course. And our listeners, you know, they might think of recent movies or the 70s TV show, but what do you think a female superhero meant to the girls growing up in the 30s and 40s?
Wonder Woman was a huge comic book hero, heroine at the time. The creator of that comic book met Alice at an event and asked her if she would endorse his work. She didn't want to do that. She agreed, well, I'll do that, but only if we can talk about real life heroines too. And so I have some of the comic books where she actually was part of the writing, and she talked about other living superheroes.
So Mary Kay, I have one of the my favorites, and I have many in your book, but I absolutely love the story of Virginia Hall. She was a remarkable, remarkable American woman who many people, when they start reading her story, find out she's not only a remarkable spy, but she actually had a prosthetic leg. I mean, her journey is just pretty incredible. There's a lot of great, great books that have been written about her. One of my favorite was Wolves at the Door by Judith Pearson, which is a great book as well. But, you know, she just was someone who she grew up, you know, very privileged. She didn't have to do what she did and risk her life. And as we know, and in reading your book and others, we know that a lot of those who served in France as you know, in the resistance efforts or in the OSS or SOE had about a 1 in 4 chance of coming back. I mean, the odds were not very good, but they did it anyway. So in Virginia Hall's case, as some of the others, can you just first of all tell me why you chose her in the book, and why was she so effective and courageous?
Many of the women I've written about were not well-known or famous, and Virginia Hall is often called a great spy. She wasn't really a spy. She was a special operator. And if you look at the organization chart for the OSS, the Office of Strategic Services, she was not in the directorate part of OSS that was spies. She was in operations. And her role was to train and forces to take on the enemy in France, which is what she did. And she was very good at it. She had worked earlier for the Special Operations Executive for the British until she was found out. And this is the part of the story where she has to escape by walking through the mountains from France into Spain, after which, of course, she's arrested because she didn't have a passport. And she's dragging that 14-pound wooden leg through the snowdrifts. Now, several years ago, there was a CIA former operator who decided to recreate her journey going through the Pyrenees, and he nearly didn't make it. So it's quite a trek to go through those mountains like that. At the time, she's on the radio and she's calling back to the office in London. And she said, "Cuthbert is giving me a hard time." Well, Cuthbert is the name of that wooden leg. Well, the person on the other end of the line didn't know that and said, "Well, if Cuthbert is bothering you, shoot him." But Virginia Hall had wanted to be in the diplomatic corps. And she couldn't quite get there. She would apply. She was turned down. Her application would be lost. She wasn't getting any help. And she continued to knock on the front door of the State Department, and she couldn't get in. And I think that some of the lessons from some of these people are more than what we just see on the surface. Now, if she had tried this today, she would have had a mentor. She would have had someone tell her how to go about it. She would have had help. She would have had women in higher positions who could tell her and give her advice on how to do things. But so many of them operated alone or without that type of support in what they did. And I loved her story for that, that she persisted in whatever way she could to be given any opportunity to make a difference. And she did. Now, she has the Distinguished Service Cross for courage in combat. the only American woman that I can find who has received that honor, that high honor. I had spoken to several of the people who worked at the CIA who brought her story out at first. And they told me they had contacted her family and said, what do you have of hers? Well, we have her radio that she used in France. Oh, could you send that? So they mailed it to the CIA historian. So I think it's on display there. And the same with the Distinguished Service Cross itself. They sent that. So I'm just amazed at what she did and how she downplayed it later in life. And she did go back and work for the CIA once it was founded and found herself marginalized. I've read that, well, she was marginalized because she was a woman. Those who were the combat vets from World War II were not liked as much as they should have been or given the respect they should have been accorded by the new generation coming in. They were looked on as the old guard. And so she made it to age 60. She retired when she could. And one of the things she'd learned from operating in France was living on a farm, and she made cheese. And she was pretty good at making cheese by that time and continued to do that.
I mean, she's just amazing on so many levels. Obviously, you get in the Distinguished Service Cross, but just to, you know, to sort of back up a little bit, I mean, she loses a foot in a shotgun accident. So that's where the whole, you know, the whole nickname comes from and all this. So this is somebody, especially from a, you know, a fairly advantaged background, could have settled into a life of some level of safety and privilege. Instead, she goes the exact opposite. She seems to seek danger wherever she can in World War II. And by now, I think it's fair to say among, you know, anybody who knows even anything about American women in World War II, she's a legend. And she's been the subject of a number of books, including, you know, A Woman of No Importance, which is massive. Was it tough for you to kind of take on the sort of, for lack of a better word, like the caricature of who she was and try and get to the nut of her story and maybe her personality somewhat? Or were there layers of myth to puncture? Or was it pretty straightforward in investigating her story?
There is quite a bit written about her. I think there's at least six books written about Virginia Hall. But it was going through them to find the person behind the legend, as you said, and to get to who she was and to realize that she had, to some extent, been called a spy and the greatest spy of World War II. And to get beyond that into what she actually did, she was afraid for some of the things she had to do. She knew she was pursued when she was in France the first time. She knew that Klaus Barbie was looking for her. So it isn't all hearing action movie music in the background while you run and save others. No, she was obviously haunted, as many of them were. Many of them did have PTSD, or what we call that today, where they relived bad experiences or worried about them or had bad dreams. And to some extent, she refused to capitalize on the death of her colleagues in some earlier engagements. And so she wouldn't use that to advance her career later with the CIA.
And how did Barbie not catch up with her? I mean, how does she evade someone who's so relentless and really notorious by now? And she's an outlier in a way. How did she evade him?
One of her friends in the resistance showed her the wanted poster. And the wanted poster was a pretty good likeness of her. And that's when she started to go and to run, because she couldn't stay any longer. And that's how she ends up back in London after that trip through the Pyrenees. And the special operations executive says, well, we can't send you back, but I want to go back. I'm bored. I want to go back. And so here comes the OSS, and they said, we'll take you, but to a different place and in disguise, because she had a rolling walk, a rolling gait because of that wooden leg. So what they did was give her padded clothing, dye her hair. They changed her teeth a little bit, too, and then gave her a shuffling walk. So she was an old woman on the farm, carrying a staff and making cheese.
In the
barn is where she had the radio, where she would call for airdrops to bring in food and weapons and money, and then to help the pilots depart.
And she had quite a role leading up to D-Day, too. I mean, they were helping blow up bridges and do, you know, telephone lines, all of that. I mean, she was directly involved in what was going on behind the lines prior to D-Day. So just incredible.
That was her role, was to prevent the German forces from being able to reinforce the Germans in northern France.
Yeah. Incredible.
Well, if Virginia Hall is a legend, Hilda Gimple Eisen is much less well known and certainly just as heroic. So tell us a little bit about Hilda. She was a partisan fighter against the Germans, a Holocaust survivor. What qualities helped her to thrive in these just unthinkable circumstances she faced?
Hilda's was actually the first story I'd found. I had read her obituary in the Wall Street Journal. And I read it three times because I simply could not believe what she had done, that she escaped the Nazis, not once, not twice, but three times, through guile, through her absolute unwillingness to accept the things that she thought were going to happen and to say, no, I will not take this. At first, right as the war started and the Germans invaded, her entire family was taken prisoner. She and her new husband were not living in the same place, so they escaped. They went on the run for about 2 weeks before German patrols caught up with them, and then they too ended up in the ghetto where the other members of the Jewish community were imprisoned. And she talked her way out of there. Oh, would you open the gate? I need to go do a little shopping. I'll be right back. And away they went. And then they lived for the next 3 years in that forest. It's one of those deep forests where the sunlight never touches the ground. But they couldn't afford a fire at night because it would be seen. They would sleep on embers of an earlier fire covered with branches. Now, personally, I'd be afraid of catching on fire. but that's how they made it through the winters. And when I saw her testimony, one of the things she said was, I've never been cold again after that, which you could imagine. She was out in the forest one day gathering firewood, and a Gestapo patrol finds her, captures her, and she had a gun on her. So they were not happy about that. They take her to their headquarters, which is in an old schoolhouse upstairs, and they're going to interrogate her later. She hears someone else being interrogated down the hall and says, no, I will not take this, and jumps out the window. Out the window of the second story, the guards outside are shooting at her, and she runs. She runs through the night to get back to the forest. We come to the end of the war. Her husband has been killed. She goes back to the town where she grew up. There is nothing left. Of course, they don't know what happened to their families. They don't know where they are at this time or where they were taken. The only thing she has left of her entire family is a little piece of embroidery that was hanging on the wall in the kitchen. And there's several other young people there. If you had returned from Auschwitz or from wherever else they'd been held, and there is Harry Eisen, who she remembers from junior high. And she didn't like Harry much in junior high, but by then she thought, I do like him. And he reminds me of all of the past that we've lost. And so she and Harry decide to go forward together. They leave Poland because the Polish people are killing the Jewish survivors. And they end up southeast of Munich in a very large displaced persons camp there. One that is later visited by Ruth Gruber with the investigative team from the U.S. She finally finds an American cousin, a distant cousin, to sponsor them, because you have to be sponsored if you're going to immigrate to the U.S. And they end up in California. And then that was the last escape. But to me, that is still in their minds, still in their past, until that next year when they're married now, they have a new baby. And Harry is working in a hot dog factory because it's the only job he can get because they're trying to learn English. And the neighbors knock on the door. They don't know it's the neighbors, but a knock on the door when you don't know anyone in a new place, that's still frightening. They didn't open the door. They wait till the people leave, then open the door and see that the neighbors have brought Christmas gifts for the baby. And to me, that's the moment when they knew they could go on. So they save their money, buy a few chickens, and Harry starts selling eggs on the back of his bicycle. By the time they sold that business in 2002, they had 800,000 chickens 450 employees and an annual income of over $10 million. That's the American dream, coming from less than nothing to being able to have the wherewithal to make a huge difference in the world. And they did. They were quite the philanthropist, too.
General, you tell about several women who served in the Office of Strategic Services, and there's got to be certain qualities that would make someone a valuable asset in the espionage business. You know, not everyone can survive that world and do well in it. So I'd like for you to tell us about Stephanie Check and her experiences in that.
Well, Stephanie spoke Polish like a native. Her parents were Polish immigrants. She didn't learn English until she started grade school. So she had a mentor in college who helped her get into Cornell. And when she graduated, and I think it's 1938, with a degree in chemistry, she couldn't find a job. So she ends up in New York working for a gas company. And when the opportunity comes to join the Women's Army Corps, she does. I think I need to find something else to do. I need a start. And if I do this for a few years, we'll see where it goes. And so she's sent to Fort Des Moines, Iowa, to work in basic training. Now, Fort Des Moines, Iowa was not exactly an exciting place to be. And basic training is a repetitive type of job. She wanted a bigger challenge. And one of her friends, who also had a real ability with language, said, you ought to apply to the OSS. And so she did. And she was selected to be in X2, which is counterintelligence, as an agent. By the end of the war, she is in London, traveling around the countryside in a command vehicle that she had, let's say, obtained somewhere she shouldn't have, and writing reports on, you know, Nazis who are fleeing, on troop movements, on, you know, getting the hang of how you do your reports, how you, with the things you're supposed to look for. And she ends up in Austria, very close to Salzburg, where by then General Mark Clark is now the commander, trying to stabilize things in that country. And he sees that she has this vehicle. Where did you get that, Stephanie? Can't tell you, sir. I'm going to take that, not unless you can find it. So she hides the vehicle. He never does find it. And she gets back to London. And then she's assigned to Poland. This is her first real assignment now. And it's a very dangerous time by September, October 1945. By then, the OSS is disestablished. And she doesn't even know that. Her entire true identity is in the embassy in Berlin. So she ends up in Poland as though she is a Polish native, working in, it's not even an embassy for the U.S. It is a suite of rooms in the one hotel that survived the bombing in downtown Warsaw, where a number of other nations have their liaisons at the time. So it has electricity. It has running water. And most of the rest of the capital does not. In fact, when General Eisenhower visits, he said it's the most destroyed place he'd seen in Europe. And she travels the countryside, pretending to look for relatives, and meanwhile doing the reports on what is happening with the upcoming elections, what's happening with the growth of communism, are there still fleeing Nazis? And she's almost outed at one point. She is almost found out by the Russians at another point, when she is leaving the train with classified documents and she sees a Russian patrol waiting for her. She pretends to trip, drop the documents. A nice man helps her up, and she said, oh, would you mind delivering this for me? And he does, and she escapes. I had read a little bit about her nieces and nephews who were, in later years, were deathly afraid of her. That she was tough.
I mean, it really is interesting, because post-war Poland is like the Wild West, and she's, you know, on the ground operating really on her own to a great extent. She is the very definition of a field operator. You know, as you've described, and one of the things I love about your book is each chapter, it's sort of the beginning of the chapter, these really interesting sort of illustrative anecdotes that allow you to kind of get to know the person immediately. And when you were talking about Stephanie Check, You talked about how there was an OSS reunion in, I guess, 2012, and each of the veterans were talking a little bit about their experiences. And when they got to her, she said she was in X2, and there was then this hush in the room because everybody there knew what that meant in terms of field operator. And I could just so imagine this because I've, you know, seen this and been part of these kind of situations. There were all sorts of people eventually descending on her, you know, excited to talk about her. And then somebody breathlessly asked, "Did you know Julia Child?" And she snaps, "She was just a clerk or something." So what's that all about? That was really interesting to me. And I wondered if you knew a little of the background of what was up with that.
Well, Julia Child was a clerk in China. She was in China with Betty McIntosh as they were part of that group there. And Betty McIntosh wrote about numbers of people who were spies. She called them the Sisterhood of Spies. And right after the war, she also wrote her own autobiography called Undercover Girl. And Betty was a little bit of what my mother would call a smart aleck. And I might use a different term. But she certainly had opinions about many of those who she worked with or knew about, and she knew quite a bit about Julia Child. So it's no surprise that Stephanie Check would have heard about her too. And especially in later years, been, "Oh, please, I know what she did there, and it was nothing like what I did or had to do."
So Mary Kay, and a follow-up to that too, because I thought it was so interesting that when you were writing about Stephanie, it said even, so here it is, like her 100th birthday, even her family, they were unaware of her past, and all of this is coming to light and all those years later. And it's because she, as she said, she was told not to say anything. So here, you know, all those years later, she still had not really talked about her past. Is that something that you found a lot when you were researching these women, that many of the family members just had no idea?
They had no idea. And a lot of it is that generation, the greatest generation was, "Oh, I didn't do that much. I just did my part. I just did my bit." And those who did things that were classified were told, "If you talk, we will shoot you at dawn," until they came to believe that that would actually happen. And they never did talk. There were two people in the book I actually got to speak with. One was Marion Frieswick, the cartographer, and the other was Betty Robarts, who helped build the bomb machine. And so, "Betty, did you tell your kids what you did in the war?" And she said, "Well, they never asked." So when I talk about these women now, I say to people, if you have parents, if you have grandparents who are still living, who served, whether it's World War II, Korea, Vietnam, ask them. Ask them what they did. Get them to share their stories with you, because we don't want to lose those. The nurse in my book, Kate Flynn Nolan, when I had a question about something that she did or I wanted clarification, I would talk to her oldest daughter, Mary Ann. Kate and Jim Nolan had seven children. And so when I would talk to one, they would talk to the others. So, "Mary Ann, tell me how your parents got back together after the war, because he was in Japan and she was in Europe. I know she came back on the Queen Mary in December, but how did he come back? Where did they meet? How did they reunite?" And she said, "We will convene." So the brothers and sisters meet, they talk, and 2 weeks later, I'm on a deadline here. I need an answer. And finally, she called me back and she said, "We have met. None of us know." Wow. So not only is she distressed, she doesn't know, but now there's no chance of knowing because their mother had just passed away. So there's a piece of their story that's missing. So I'm sure that maybe they've gone through letters, but we'll see what they could find. And certainly, even especially after this book came out, I continued to meet people who knew them. I met Stephanie Check's neighbors from Alexandria. Not last year, the year before, I was privileged to be able to speak at the World War II International Conference in New Orleans. And afterwards, this man walked up to me and said, "Stephanie Check was my neighbor." And away he went. And I was like, "Come back." And I found him again the next day. And he introduced me to more of their neighbors who now live in Florida. And so I heard more stories about her. So it's continuing to find out more of their lives now, because I continue to meet people who knew them. I even met one of Mary Baracco's neighbors from Norfolk.
Some of the other women in your book step up to make a difference in the suffering of a lot of people. And of course, there was plenty of suffering going on during the war. You mentioned Ruth Gruber a few minutes ago. Tell us more about her, summarize the impact she had, and take a guess at what motivated her.
Ruth Gruber was an incredibly smart woman. She, at the time, she was the youngest person to graduate from college with a PhD in the world. She had graduated from, I think, the University of Wisconsin, then had a degree from overseas in Berlin. She was well aware from having been in Germany in the 1930s of seeing the changes politically and what she thought was coming with the Nazi movement. After she graduated from college, she started to work for a newspaper in New York and write for them, not just on the women's pages, but she also did an investigative piece by going to the Russian gulag. And that brought her to the attention of the Secretary of the Interior, who hired her and then sent her to Alaska, thinking if she would write about Alaska, maybe that would be a place to help people settle after the war, as there would be obviously large migrations of people to different places to live. So as she's working for him, she realizes that there is a real issue with Jewish people not being permitted to emigrate to the U.S. and escape. So President Roosevelt, by 1944, said he would invite 1,000 Jewish refugees to come in as his personal guests. She runs into her boss's office and says, but you can't let them come alone. They can't. Who's going to help them? Who's going to escort them? And he said, well, you are. And then her mother calls him and says, I don't like my daughter doing this. And he said, don't worry, we're going to make her a general. So she shows up in Italy at the ship. And there's a great movie about this, too, starring Natalie Richardson, Haven. You know, the movie was about safe haven, giving these people a safe haven in the U.S. And it's on the ship, on the way across the ocean, one night when the lights are out, the engines have stopped because they're trying to avoid submarines and enemy aircraft, where she stands on the deck and realizes, this is what I am meant to do. The rest of my life is going to be bound up with these types of stories, with people who I can help, with not with suffering, but with finding a way to deal with their issues and bring them to light and help them in this manner. She is there at Exodus in 1947 in Israel. She is really, truly the witness to some of the most incredible events of the 20th century. And she has, I think, 8 books of her photographs and her stories of the events she witnessed. Now, Witness to History, that Witness is the name of one of her books. But she remained very close to all of the people who she escorted back to the U.S. They were first interned in a camp in New York. And after they had been all questioned, you know, fully vetted, and then able to be released, they were brought into society, greater society as a whole. And throughout her life, she was proud of the things that they had been able to accomplish, the careers they had, the lives they created, and what they had become.
Yeah, I mean, she's like the ultimate witness participant in history, and obviously has the outstanding writing skills to really communicate this. And in some ways, that's her impact, don't you think? That especially, you know, Harold Ickes, the Secretary of Interior, recognizes this, and her ability as a communicator, I think, puts a lot of these folks who she's helping front and center, and really does maybe have a larger geopolitical impact. You mentioned Exodus. I mean, there she is in the middle of that situation. That's obviously incredibly pertinent to this day. I mean, so how does that affect, how does she affect events then? And then how does that affect her the rest of her life, do you think?
Well, we talk about journalism as being, you have to be impartial. And she was never impartial. She said, I must be involved and I must feel about what I'm doing. And that's exactly what she did and how she wrote, which may have been unusual in some cases, but it made her writing that much more effective, with an A, affective, and that it created I think, support for causes for the individuals who had been harmed or who had been changed by their experiences in the war. It's because she felt what they were feeling and she was able to transmit that. I talked to her son, who is in Washington, and was able to get his perspective. You know, she was in a study because she didn't pass away until the age of 105. So she was in a study on longevity at some point, but she was certainly active in also promoting journalism and journalism, I think, awards and scholarships. So she was active throughout her entire life, and she still has impact. Now, when you read stories about correspondence from World War II, there were over 350 women correspondents. She's not listed among them because she wasn't specifically a war correspondent, but she had more access. She sat in part of the Nuremberg trials. She had been part of a study group at the end of the war that visited some of the displaced persons camps. She saw so much and was able to write about so much more than so many ever would have had access to.
Mary Kay, I know we're getting close on time, but I did want to ask this one question about Mary Privity. I hope I'm saying her name right. But I mean, you know, we talk a lot about these women who are making these choices to do what they did. But, you know, oftentimes just looking at young children, young girls. And I think Mary and her experience really teaches us something, too, about resilience at a very, very young age and what she went through. Can you just quickly tell us a little bit about her experience and, you know, why her war was a little different?
Mary Taylor Previty was a child in World War II. From the ages of 9 to 12, she and her brothers and sister were in a concentration camp in China. Her parents were missionaries. And when the Japanese attacked their boarding school, they were all taken prisoner. They were made to go to school. Like, you are not going to get behind in your schoolwork, the adults would say to her. And there is not one rule for the princesses in London and another for you. So they were distracted. And they were, as she found out later, doing very well in their schoolwork. But yes, there was an effect there. And certainly there was a group of survivors that she belonged to for the remainder of her life. She grew up, became an English teacher, then a member of the school board in New Jersey, then ran for the state Senate, and then decided, I need to thank the people who saved me. There was a Jedburgh team that came out of the OSS office in China, where Betty McIntosh was, that one of her friends was part of that group. He was an artist, so he did sketches of them as they were rescued. They parachuted into the camp because they were afraid, the Americans were afraid that after the end of the war, the Japanese soldiers, if they didn't know the war was over, would kill the prisoners. So they liberated the camps. She was reunited with her parents, but those experiences never left her. So she wanted to thank those men, and she made it a point for the next several years. She tracked down as many as of them that were still living and personally thanked them. She called them my falling angels. Now, I learned another story about her, too, after the book came out. I told you about Kate Nolan's daughter, Marianne. Marianne called me and said, I want you to meet my sister-in-law, Carolyn. Well, Carolyn grew up in that part of New Jersey and said, I read the book, my sister-in-law gave it to me, and I really loved the story about Kate, but then I realized there's Mary Previty. She was my neighbor. What are the chances?
That's incredible.
And she was a force of nature, not just in her professional life, but in our neighborhood. She said it was 1974, Nixon had just resigned, the Vietnam War is winding down. There was a 4th of July barbecue with the neighbors. There might have been Bloody Marys and mimosas. But the discussion was, what's wrong with our country? How do we get back a sense of patriotism that we haven't seen since those days? So they decided, Mary decided, and dragged them all along, to have a 4th of July parade. So the neighbors all sewed together this gigantic American flag, which was carried every year for 50 years in their 4th of July parade. Now, 2020, there's no parade. And of course, Mary had just passed away, but they put that flag up in front of her house and people would come by just to touch it. And the parade started again last year.
Wow. That, I mean, talk about meaningful. General Mary Eder, this has just been such a pleasure. I really appreciate you coming on to talk about your fascinating book. Again, it's called The Girls Who Stepped Out of Line. Thank you so much for joining us. It's been great.
Thank you so much.
John Long, please tell us about today's We Salute You.
Today, continuing our exploration of women in World War II on our We Salute You feature, we will honor the service of Mildred Haley Allen, a corporal in the Women's Army Corps in the European Theater. Mildred Haley was born in Roanoke, Virginia in 1921 and grew up with many of the young men who would form the nucleus of Company D, 116th Regiment, in World War II, including the future founder of the National D-Day Memorial, Bob Slaughter. Mildred attended Jefferson High School there and then went on to National Business College. Soon after graduation, she became enamored of one William Earl Allen, a National Guard officer in the 29th Division. The Virginia National Guard had been called up into the regular army in February of 1941 for a year of training. Sensing that the war in Europe may extend that service, Earl proposed marriage to Mildred. Then, 2 months after their wedding day, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor and made clear that instead of a one-year hitch, the 29th Division was in the war for the duration. In the fall of 1942, the 29th shipped out for England to prepare for the eventual cross-channel attack. Mildred Allen was left alone, working for the local power company and feeling less than useful with a war going on. Then she heard that women were being recruited for a new Women's Army Corps, and she said, "I could hardly wait my turn to sign up." Mildred assumed that she would serve stateside, but Uncle Sam had other plans. An officer let slip that Mildred was being considered for a special WAC detachment to go to England, and specifically they wanted her because her husband was already there. Mildred suspected that the Army was hoping to recruit other Army wives with the vague promise that if they enlisted in the WAC, they might be posted near their husband. It was a bait and switch. While such an arrangement could happen, and it did with Mildred and Earl, it was highly unusual. Nevertheless, Mildred found herself in England and soon reunited with her husband, with reporters in tow. A staged photo of Mildred saluting her lieutenant husband was featured in American newspapers across the country. Mildred was highly photogenic and was used as the face of the WAC several times, in one case helping to plot the location of enemy aircraft on a map, although she would later admit this was not my job and she wasn't sure how to use the mapping tools. Her actual job was performing clerical work for a colonel in the Army Air Forces, overseeing material and supplies in England. It wasn't glamorous work, but it was necessary, and Mildred was content that she was contributing to victory. She got to know many of the airmen of the 9th Air Force and wept with her fellow WACs when a crew failed to return after a raid. Mildred and Earl were indeed able to see each other a few times, though they were apart more than they were together. Mildred especially enjoyed dances with the men of her husband's regiment, many of whom were her former neighbors and classmates, and some of whom who would never return from France. Earl served in the D-Day landings and afterwards in the fight through France. Mildred, however, discovered that she was pregnant with their first child, and per WAC regulations, was forced to give up her military career and return to Virginia. Earl survived the war and eventually left the Army as a lieutenant colonel. The couple returned to Roanoke, raised their family of a daughter and three sons, and enjoyed a productive, happy life. They eventually welcomed 6 grandchildren and 4 great-grandchildren before Earl died in 2004. Mildred then became a great supporter of the National D-Day Memorial and would swap letters with Bob Slaughter and with the memorial staff, telling stories from her time in the Army. That correspondence is now part of the archive at the memorial. In an interview in 2012, Mildred Allen reflected on women's service in World War II and concluded that it, quote, gave women responsibility to their country and to themselves that they never had before. I loved it, she exclaimed. Mildred Haley Allen died in 2019 at the age of 98. Corporal Allen, we salute you. Thank you for your service, and thank you for doing your part to save the world.
That's great. And, you know, so many of the women that I've talked to served said the same thing. It was some of the best years of their lives was in service.
And, you know, you know what strikes me about her story, too, and this is something that takes a long time to change and alleviate. I mean, as soon as she gets pregnant, oh, boom, that's the end of her military career. Now she has to go home. You know, I mean, that's another sort of equivalency that is hard won over time.
And, it's
intergeneration.
Also somewhat surprising they would put her near her husband for that very reason, because I'm sitting here thinking, what happens when
that's true too,
when the
that's shocking. I mean, they were very for
propaganda value.
Well, that's true.
That other women might sign up thinking, I'll be near my husband. You know what percentage were, you know,
tiny percentage. Well,
I had borrowed some uniforms from the Military Women's Memorial to use in making a trailer for the book. And one of them was a Coast Guard uniform that had a pregnancy skirt. And I said,
wow.
They didn't have those then. And she said, well, I think this woman made it herself.
You got to do what you got to do. Right?
Wow. That's improvisation, military improvisation. Right. There we go.
And a very large jacket to go with it.
Well, General Mary Eder, I'd like to thank you again for being our guest, for talking about your amazing book, The Girls Who Stepped Out of Line. It's been such an honor to have you today. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Well, you can email our team at podcast@dday.org. If you're enjoying our discussions on World War II and its lasting impact, please subscribe to this podcast, share it with your friends, rate it, and leave us a review. We'd love to hear from you. Help us share the lessons and legacies of D-Day and World War II. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Take care.
Someone Talked is a production of the National D-Day Memorial Foundation in partnership with Watts Creative Studios. Views expressed are not necessarily those of the foundation. This program was supported by a grant from Virginia Humanities. Virginia Humanities connects people and ideas to explore the human experience and inspire cultural engagement. As the State Humanities Council, Virginia Humanities reaches millions in its estimated annual audience through festivals, grants, fellowships, digital initiatives, teacher institutes, radio programs, podcasts, apprenticeships, and school programs. Headquartered at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia Humanities works to serve Virginians in every corner of the Commonwealth. To learn more, visit virginiahumanities.org. Located in Bedford, Virginia, the community that suffered the highest known D-Day loss per capita in the United States, Congress warranted the establishment of the nation's monument to D-Day in this emblematic American homefront. Receiving no federal or state funding, the memorial is operated and maintained by a private foundation and donor support. Explore the National D-Day Memorial, plan your visit, and learn more about upcoming events at dday.org. Join the conversation. Email our team at podcast@dday.org.
It's no military secret that I love you.
Hey, how about romancing?
If you can keep a secret,
well, can I take you dancing?
If you'll take my heart and keep it, I'm not saying a word. I'm careful whatever I do.
I guess everyone's heard. I want to give all my love to you.
If you gotta talk to someone, don't give any information. It's smart to be a dumb one. Simply change the conversation.
Let's talk about love.
That's what I'm thinking of.
It's no secret, no secret. It's no secret that I love you.